Welcome to Ben Franklin's World, a podcast about early American history with Liz Covart. The study of history is key to understanding who we are and how we can affect a better future. Ben Franklin's World will introduce you to historical people and events that have impacted and shaped our present-day world. And now, here's your host, Liz Covart.
Hello, and welcome to a bonus episode of Ben Franklin's World, the podcast dedicated to helping you learn more about how the people and events of our early American past have shaped the present-day world we live in. Each week, we sit down with an historian to discuss their unique insights into our early American past so we can learn more about who we are and how we can affect a better future. Today, I offer you a bonus episode, which came about because you asked for it. Over the last month or so, I have received your emails, and I have seen your tweets and posts in Poor Richard's Club, our private Facebook community of Ben Franklin's World listeners. All of these emails, tweets, and posts comprised one request. Interview someone associated with the Hermione voyage of 2015, the voyage that commemorates the Marquis de Lafayette and the role the French Navy played in helping the United States secure its independence. Well, you asked for it, and now you have it. Your interview with Miles Young, president of the Friends of Hermione-Lafayette in America organization. During our conversation, Miles reveals who the Marquis de Lafayette was and why he joined the American Revolution on behalf of the Patriots. Details about Lafayette's involvement in the American Revolution and his relationship with George Washington. And an inside look at the Hermione voyage of 2015. Miles shares what it was like to make the transatlantic crossing and where we can see the Hermione during her remaining ports of call. I know you're excited about this one, so without further ado, allow me to introduce you to Miles Young.
With tidings and wisdom to share about our early American past, here is this week's special guest.
Miles Young is president of the Friends of Hermione-Lafayette in America, the organization responsible for the Hermione voyage 2015. In addition to being a scholar of Lafayette, Miles serves as the chairman and CEO for Ogilvy & Mather Worldwide, one of the largest marketing and communications companies in the world. Welcome to Ben Franklin's World, Miles.
Thank you very much. It's very good to be here.
The Hermione voyage of 2015, a transatlantic journey that commemorates both the Marquis de Lafayette and the ship who brought him to the United States in 1780, has captivated the early American historical community. And I can't wait to talk about your amazing project. But before we dive into that discussion, I think we should first discuss Lafayette and what he meant to the Patriots' war effort. So, Miles, would you provide us with a brief overview of who the Marquis de Lafayette was?
Well, he was, in fact, a most interesting person who had a number of very distinct periods to his life. I mean, fundamentally, of course, he was one of the most precocious teenagers in history. So it was a very, very young Lafayette who became excited by the cause of American independence and who decided to join up. He came from a very wealthy family. His father had been killed at the Battle of Minden by the British. That was when Lafayette was really only a toddler. He left a lot of letters, which Lafayette subsequently read as he was growing up. So he was strongly influenced by his father and also a sense of grievance at the loss of his father for all of his life. He had his great phase in the American Revolution. He then had a second phase of his life in the French Revolution, which was probably more controversial, certainly in France, in retrospect. After a period of imprisonment and more or less internal exile, he then came back with glory again in the last part of his life with an amazing trip back to the United States in 1825, where he was received as a conquering hero. And then, of course, he was part of the July Revolution in 1830, the liberal monarchy of Louis Philippe. So he had those very distinct periods, but he was someone who, you know, really earns a sobriquet, hero of two worlds, because he did span both the history of America and the history of France in a remarkable way.
He seems to be very involved in revolutions. In fact, when he joined the American Revolution, he seems to have started a revolution of his own. When he joined up in 1777, he did so against the wishes of King Louis XVI of France. So would you tell us, you know, What really possessed Lafayette to join the American Revolution and fight on behalf of the new United States, who many considered the underdog? And why did King Louis XVI disapprove of his actions?
Well, I think Lafayette was always an idealist. So he was very much influenced by a sense of idealism, a sense of adventure, a sense of daring do. He was also influenced to some extent by the people around him. So there were French people of slightly dubious background who were promoting trips to America at that time. Silas Deane, of course, was recruiting French aristocrats in large numbers to go and fight for the American cause. So he got wrapped up in that kind of excitement. And he then, you know, extricated himself from the rest of them very, very quickly. But he was part of that rush to America. The French government, of course, weren't keen at that time to do anything to create a cause of war with Great Britain more than already existed. So France had made it clear that it supported America, it had lent some military support, but it was far short of committing to a full-scale major military operation. So the French government and Louis XVI were actually just terrified that this sort of thing would provoke something which they weren't at that point in time committed to.
One aspect of Lafayette that Americans always seem to remember is that he befriended George Washington and that they had a very close relationship. Would you tell us how and when Lafayette befriended George Washington and what that relationship meant for Lafayette?
Well, after Lafayette arrived in the States, as you know, he more or less paid for his own ship and he sailed to South Carolina. He then moved up from Charleston to Philadelphia. He met Washington in the City Tavern, actually, in Philadelphia. Washington quickly realized that there was some quality about Lafayette. One of the interesting things about Washington as a president is that he was always a great user of espionage and a great lover of spying. He, in fact, I think, used Lafayette a little bit as an internal source of information in his own camp. He was someone that you could trust because he was an outsider. So I think that it was, at one level, a utility that Lafayette gave to Washington. But after that, they developed this friendship. You know, as I said, Lafayette had lost his father, and Washington never really had a son. So there was this father-son relationship, or even sometimes almost like a fraternal brotherly relationship between them, with jokes and a lot of affection in it. So it was a friendship, and it was a friendship which lasted until Washington's death.
Lafayette was a soldier, and he served at the Battle of Brandywine when he was wounded in September 1777. Would you tell us how he came to be wounded and perhaps what other battles he served in as well?
He was used by Washington. He rapidly became recognized as being a good commander, even if a little bit hot-headed. So Washington allowed him his head. At Brandywine, he really was rallying troops. So he was in a defensive role. He got hurt, not terribly badly, but it was enough to knock him out a bit. And ultimately, it led to his return to France the next year.
As you mentioned, Lafayette did return to France in 1778, and he went there to convalesce from his wounds, but also to seek support from King Louis XVI and his foreign minister, the Comte de Vernier. Could you tell us about how he went about trying to get support from the French government and whether he proved successful in his efforts?
He was an ultimate lobbyist. The great thing about Lafayette actually was his wife. He had a fantastic wife who was called Adrienne de Lafayette. She was one of the Noailles family. She was very well connected. Lafayette was also well connected. So when he went back to France to seek French help, he had a network that he could operate. He used that. He also was a ferocious advocate. You know, he used to bombard people like Vergennes with letters. All the French cabinet ministers received letters from him. Of course, it was a very urgent situation. By early 1780, if you'd been an impartial observer, you might have said that the insurgents would lose the war. The British had invaded South Carolina, captured Charleston. There was a string of British victories, and Washington was holed up in very adverse circumstances in Morristown, New Jersey. So the words being used at that time were now or never. And it was on that basis that ultimately Louis XVI, as chief executive, came off the fence. Maurepas, prime minister, Vergennes, also supported an intervention. The decision was made to launch a full-scale expeditionary force, the Expedition Particulière, which would involve sending a modern, well-equipped, and well-trained army to America.
What was Lafayette's return to America like when he went back in 1780, and what prompted him to return?
Well, he got the orders to transmit the message to Washington from Louis XVI that support was coming and not to give up, in essence. So it was very, very critical. He was given the Hermione to sail to Boston on. So he went down to Rochefort, where the Hermione was made ready for him. Its young captain was called La Touche Trévis, and they sailed as quickly as they could to Boston. Lafayette loved the ship. He wrote in a letter, "She sails like a bird." She was a very fast frigate. They avoided British raiders on the way. They arrived off the coast of Massachusetts at Marblehead, then made their way to Boston, moored at Hancock's Wharf, and he was received with acclaim. But his main interest was getting down to Morristown as quickly as possible. So he rode to Morristown and told Washington the news. That, in a sense, is a tipping point in American history.
What role did Lafayette and the Hermione play in the war for American independence between 1780 and 1781?
After that, the Hermione, you say Hermione, I say Hermione, it doesn't matter. after that, she was involved in North Atlantic warfare. And it's quite interesting because at that time, the naval war was really a war against convoys. The British were entirely dependent on the home country for their supplies. They weren't able to generate supplies from America itself, which was a hostile environment. They were, to some extent, by this stage, an army of occupation. So everything had to be supplied long distance by sea. It was an extraordinary feat, by the way, on their part to keep armies in the field on that basis. But what it meant was that the convoys, which were protected by British frigates, were the target for French raids. So the Hermione was essentially a raider, and she played a significant role in a number of captures of, or defeats of convoys, including a notable one off the coast of Canada in 1781. Then, very late in the day, just as things were reaching the end point in Chesapeake Bay, she was called down from Newport to join the blockade of Chesapeake Bay. She carried gunpowder there for the soldiers, and witnessed the surrender of the British at Yorktown. So there's an entry in the captain's journal which describes the surrender.
She really is significant in that she stands for the larger French fleet that really played a pivotal role in the American Revolution. So it's neat that you have this project that commemorates both Lafayette and, in some ways, the French Navy.
Absolutely. You know, the friendship between U.S. and France has been enduring. There have only been a couple of times in history when it's even been remotely poor. And indeed, the history between the American and the French navies is very strong. We're particularly pleased because the U.S. Navy Museum in the Navy Yard in Washington, D.C. has just put on an exhibition called Twin Destinies, stimulated by the Hermione, which is about the long-term relationship between the two navies.
Both the Hermione and Lafayette witnessed Yorktown. They saw Cornwallis surrender. When did Lafayette take his leave of the United States and George Washington? And what happened to the Hermione after her return to France?
Lafayette really took a temporary leave of Washington because he came back a few years later and visited the States. And then, of course, they were in permanent correspondence. But it was an emotional leave-taking when it happened. Of course, also, when Lafayette was in difficult circumstances, the Washingtons looked after his son, who was called George Washington Lafayette. The Hermione returned to France and then was sent to the Indian Ocean to take part in the naval wars there against the British. It fought well there. It came back to France during the Revolutionary War. It was also engaged. And then at one point in the 1790s, it ran foul of a reef off the coast of Brittany, and it foundered. And actually, it was discovered again in the late 80s in the last century. And that was one of the stimulus for the idea of rebuilding a new Hermione.
Before we move on to the Hermione voyage of 2015, I have a listener question. You had mentioned earlier that after the American Revolution, Lafayette took part in the French Revolution. And Chris mentioned that on his recent trip to Mount Vernon, the docent showed him the key to the Bastille, which Lafayette supposedly gave to George Washington. Do you know if Lafayette really presented Washington with the key to the Bastille? And if so, how did he come by that key?
Well, the answer is yes, you did. It was sent, by the way. It wasn't presented by hand. It is a genuine key of the Bastille. There are a number. Well, Lafayette was actually present when Bastille was sacked, and he was in charge of the National Guard at that stage. So that's why he has something of a mixed reputation in France. He was caught up in the revolution and unable to control it. I don't think he can be blamed for that. But at this particular moment, when the fall of the Bastille symbolized the end of oppression, he was there recognizing that it was symbolic of the importance of liberty. So on an impulse, he took one of those keys and he sent it to George Washington, and it is in the hallway of Mount Vernon right now.
Now that we understand who the Marquis de Lafayette was and the role he and his ship, the Hermione, played in the war for American independence, let's talk about the Hermione voyage of 2015. The Hermione stands as one of the largest and most authentically built tall ships to launch in the last 150 years. Would you tell us where the idea to rebuild an exact replica of the Hermione came from and about the historical research and work that went into building that exact replica?
The idea emerged in the town of Rochefort. Rochefort had been a French naval construction yard for many years. It was founded by Colbert, the great minister of Louis XIV. The naval docks still existed there, even though they weren't operating. But the town had fallen into some economic decline. In particular, it had been knocked around very badly by the Germans in the Second World War. So in the 1990s, the mayor of Rochefort, Monsieur Frot, a visionary, decided that he would try to rebuild the old historic center. So this involved a number of things. The Cordonnerie Royale, which is the place where the old ropes in the French Navy were made, was reconstructed a little bit earlier. And then the idea came out of that that the project could be capped, if you like, by a ship rebuilding project. So the idea came about, well, let's reconstruct the Hermione. It had such an important role in history. It was therefore, in the start, an urban regeneration project as much as anything else.
Did you have to go out and find special workers to build a ship in 18th century style?
Yes, absolutely, because the decision was taken that this should be a very authentic reconstruction. You know, a lot of tall ships that look original aren't original. If you poke underneath the surface, there's a lot of metal and a lot of compromise. There's very little compromise here. There are some things that had to be put in for reasons of safety, like an engine, but as little as possible the engine is used. So here the big issue is finding the oak trees, the massive oak trees, to build the hull and to find them sustainably as well. So in the old French naval forests, they were bred, and they were bred to a certain shape. You know, they were curved so that you could use the curves. So you can't just go out and find any oak tree. So this took a long time. It took many, many years to assemble the right number of trees in the right format. But there are all sorts of other things as well which are authentic. The ropes, the sails, every eye of every sail is sewn by hand. The cannons were founded according to the exact specification of the original cannons, and so on and so forth. So to all intents and purposes, when you step onto the ship, you are stepping onto an 18th century French warship.
Where did you find the plans for the Hermione? Were they in the French National Archives, or where did you find them?
Funnily enough, not. A sister ship of the Hermione had been captured by the British and measured drawings taken, because this was a bit of advanced technology at the time, so it was interesting to the enemy. Those drawings still remain in the British Admiralty, or in truth, they belong to the Admiralty, but they're in the Maritime Museum in Greenwich. So it was those that were the basis for the three-dimensional model on which the new Hermione was built.
April would like to know what your transatlantic voyage in the new Hermione was like, and whether you encountered any unexpected difficulties.
There was really no difficulty. The captain will tell you that she handles magnificently. And he also describes this extraordinary fact that at some times in the right conditions, it feels as if she's surfing along the top of the waves. So there's something about the engineering of these vessels that is very, very, very particular, which gave them the speed that they needed. So actually, the crossing was quicker than expected. The new Hermione had to loiter a bit off the Virginia Capes because we had some days spare. The only real challenge we've had was probably the arrival in Annapolis on Monday. She has a quite a reasonable draft, and we needed 19 feet of depth. That's pushing it a bit in Annapolis, but we had a very skilled pilot from the Maryland Pilots. The captain is unbelievably skilled, and we made our way into Annapolis, which is probably the most challenging of the ports that we are going to, in a practical sense, as we move up the coast.
What was it like to make the transatlantic crossing in terms of eating and living conditions? How authentic did your voyage get?
They're pretty authentic. A lot of people are sleeping in hammocks, not everyone. We've had to put in latrines, which didn't exist before. The food is obviously modern food, and it's also designed to keep the crew healthy and well-nourished. But otherwise, if you talk to the crew, who, by the way, all wear clothes which look and feel like 18th century French sailors' clothes, in other words, there wasn't a uniform at that stage. If you talk to them, they will say that they felt the experience was pretty authentic.
Would you tell us what we can expect when we come visit the Hermione in one of her remaining ports of call?
You can expect to climb up a gangplank and then essentially find yourself in the 18th century. You're standing on an 18th century warship, a piece of superb marine technology, admittedly a killing machine, but a vessel that evokes the past in a quite remarkable way. And by the way, you can smell it as well, because you can smell the tar on the hemp. So this is not like a modern warship. You can really get a sensory experience of what it must have been like to have stood on its deck all those years ago as it sailed into Boston Harbor.
I am often grateful that we can't smell history, because I'm not sure it would have smelled so great, but that sounds awesome to count on the Hermione and be able to smell her.
I recommend it. You won't find it offensive in any way. You'll enjoy it. And the crew are very friendly.
Is there some aspect of the tour of the ship that people have found more fascinating than others? Like, is there some aspect of the ship that really captivates people's attention that we should be on the lookout for?
I think people are very excited when we fire the cannons, I have to say. That is a spectacular sight. You can see the Hermione. You see what it was meant for. But you see the smoke coming out of the cannons. It is just highly evocative.
The Hermione is really only on the East Coast until mid to late July. Jennifer would like to know about the long-term plans for the ship when she returns to France. So what will happen to the Hermione after her return voyage to France?
It's not totally decided yet, but she will return to Rochefort and then probably spend some time in Rochefort, some time in La Rochelle. The one thing we're very clear about is that we have to sail her. If you have a tall ship reconstruction like this and you don't put her to work, you start to get problems in time. There's a famous Swedish ship, the Göteborg, which had some sort of problems like that. So we want to make as much use of her as possible. Once every few years, we hope to have long voyages again. It would be lovely to come back to the States. I think it would be great to come back to the southern part of the eastern coast. I think at some stage, there's even the idea of going to Asia. So all's up for grabs at the moment. To be honest, our attention is single-mindedly focused on getting us safely back from the United States and Canada in July.
That's not a small feat, so I can understand why you'd be focused on that. Let's turn our attention to the time warp. This is a fun segment of the show where we ask you a hypothetical history question about what might have happened if something had occurred differently or if someone had acted differently.
The time warp. Historians can't predict the future, but they can speculate about what might have been.
Miles, in your opinion, what might have happened if Lafayette had not defied King Louis XVI and joined the cause of the American Revolution in 1777? How might the revolution and the United States' ties with France and Great Britain be different?
You know, it could very well have happened that the people who were more pessimistic in Washington's camp could have persuaded him to have sued for a negotiated peace. And let's not forget that at that stage, there were those in the British government who also very much wanted to have a negotiated settlement. Lord North, the Prime Minister, was one of those, though history doesn't often report that. So one possible outcome could have been a negotiated settlement which preserved some link to the mother country and the crown in a much reduced form, but allowed the rebels many of their economic and social demands.
Would you tell us where and when we can see the Hermione?
Yes, she's at the moment in Annapolis, Maryland, and she'll move to Baltimore at the end of the week. The week after that, she'll be in Philadelphia. On July the 1st, she'll come to New York. July the 4th, if anyone's got a boat, by the way, they're very welcome to join our parade around the Statue of Liberty. That's going to be a truly fantastic celebration of Independence Day. Then she moves the following week to Greenport, Long Island, and Newport, Rhode Island. Then to Boston, Massachusetts, and finally on Bastille Day to Castine, Maine. Now, Castine used to be the capital of French America, briefly. So around Castine, there still is a French-speaking population, so it's highly appropriate that we'll spend Bastille Day there.
I'm very much looking forward to your stop in Boston. I plan on stopping by myself.
Make sure you introduce yourself. I shall be there.
Fantastic. Where is the best place to look for more information about you, the Hermione Voyage of 2015, and how to get in contact with either you or the Friends of Hermione-Lafayette in America organization?
We have a website. Just Google Hermione. You'll find it very, very easily. That website has got details of everything about the program, the history. There's a live blog. There are links to other interesting sites. And also there's a mechanism there for contacting us if anyone wants more information.
And you won't even have to Google it because I will include links to the website in the show notes page for this episode. Miles, thank you so much for helping us explore the life of the Marquis de Lafayette and for the inside look at the Hermione voyage of 2015. We really wish you a safe return voyage.
Thank you so much. I'm most grateful to you for your interest.
The Marquis de Lafayette played an important role in the American Revolution. As Miles revealed, Lafayette proved an invaluable ally who helped to coax his king and government into supporting the rebellious Americans. This was not a small feat when you think about it. What must it have been like for King Louis XVI to support a foreign people who desired to separate from the rule of their king? He's a king. He's trying to support people who want to overthrow a king? I know the historic animosity between the French and British played a role in his decision, but even still, Louis supported a people who desired to throw off the rule of their sovereign. This is heavy, so I'm going to let you think about this for a bit. Also, did you catch the part where Miles said that the French grew curved trees and a special naval force to build its fleet? Amazing. Thank you for requesting this interview. Honestly, I wasn't going to pursue it because I thought there wouldn't be enough time to make it happen. But you asked, and I'm glad you did, because I enjoyed our chat with Miles, and I can't wait to see the Hermione when she makes port in Boston on July 11th. Have you seen or will you see the Hermione? Let us know and post your pictures so we can help our friends who don't live along the eastern seaboard see the ship from a firsthand perspective. Please post your pictures in Poor Richard's Club or tweet them using the hashtag BFWorld. You can find more information about Hermione and the Friends of Hermione Lafayette in America organization, plus notes for everything we talked about today on the show notes page for this episode. You'll find it all at benfranklinsworld.com/Lafayette. I figured Lafayette was a bit easier to spell than Hermione, so benfranklinsworld.com/Lafayette. Would you like to receive access to Poor Richard's Club, the social community for Ben Franklin's World listeners, or receive the show notes for each episode in your inbox? If so, text BFWorld to 33444 to sign up for the Franklin Gazette so you can receive the show notes for next week's episode and for every episode after that right in your inbox. Finally, if you have any more requests for awesome interviews or just want to chat about history or provide feedback for the show, send an email to liz@benfranklinsworld.com or tweet me at Liz Covart.
And remember, never leave till tomorrow that which you can do today.